And there are, to EJ's points, some discussions going on. And that's why we've brought in Aaron Portsline from The Athletic to talk about the bumpiness of what could be negotiations that are critical for Artemi's future and the Blue Jackets. What do we know right now about those negotiations?
Well, we know that they met today in Nice, France, for about 45 minutes. The purpose of this, from Jarmo Kekalainen's perspective, heading into the meeting, was not to persuade him to change his mind, was not to beg him, certainly, but to simply lay out what the next 12 months holds if he remains in Columbus and does not sign a contract extension with the Blue Jackets. He could be traded. He could be traded before the season starts. He could be traded a month into the season. He could be held on to the trade deadline, perhaps even beyond that, if Columbus is in the hunt. Nobody knows where this is going. It can change in a moment if Artemi Panarin says, I've changed my mind. I would like to sign long-term in Columbus. But at this point, he is unwilling to negotiate with them. That did not change with today's meeting. And so the waiting game continues between the Blue Jackets and Panarin.
Aaron, do you get any sense that he may change his mind?
I don't get that sense, no. I mean, you can't certainly dismiss that possibility, but he could change on a whim. It could be, there could be outside influences that are helping to determine where he wants to play. And maybe he decides that I do want to stay there. I like the situation. I like the coach. I like the teammates, whatever. But at this point, I mean, it's being portrayed by the agent and by his camp. And I can see this as a favor to the Blue Jackets to let them know a year out, unlike other situations, Jonathan Tavares comes to mind, that I don't plan to stay here necessarily, or right now I don't want to sign an extension with you. And so get the best deal you can, or handle this the way you think best. And he's certainly giving them some, early sign here that maybe what would be best would be for them to move on without him. But there's no indication that that's close either.
What kind of a position does this put the team in, considering everything you just said?
Yeah, it's a tough situation. I mean, it's really tough because this is their best forward for sure, one of their best players, probably the best forward that's ever played for the organization, a guy that they were planning to build around. And so in a sense, by him saying, I am not ready to negotiate with you long term, and it looking like he's not going to sign with the Blue Jackets, he's almost an unrestricted free agent already, because no team is going to give the Blue Jackets even a reasonable return for a player of Artemi Panarin's ilk unless they're sure they can re-sign him long term. And so what is that list? That's something else that may have come out of today, that maybe Jarmo Kekalainen and the Blue Jackets have some direction in terms of what teams they should be calling, what teams could logically think they could sign Panarin long-term and then would be willing to give Columbus a return that would be worthy of a player of Panarin. And that is what's so tricky right now, is the offers clearly that Jarmo Kekalainen has gotten so far are not strong enough to accept. Certainly, I'm led to believe that they're not really strong enough at this point to even consider.
All right, Aaron, we have another key player for the Blue Jackets in exactly the same situation. Sergei Bobrovsky, the final year of his contract. What do you know about the contract discussions, if there have been any, between the club and their star goaltender?
Yeah, I mean, EJ, what's crazy here is this could be exactly like Panarin, and it's not getting the attention that Panarin is for the simple fact that neither side has said anything. The only thing that Jarmo Kekalainen has said, and this was at the draft in Dallas, is that there's been dialogue between the two sides. One assumes that dialogue is a negotiation of sorts. I'm not sure what else they would be talking about. If that is the case, then that alone makes it different than the Panarin situation. That's a good thing. They have had issues, difficulty with Bobrovsky getting him under contract in previous negotiations. So that I think they expected of the two that Panarin would be the easier of the two. And now here we sit. But the Bobrovsky one has been quiet. I think it's interesting to some people that those two, Panarin and Bobrovsky, are doing extensive traveling together this summer. They're both in Nice, France. Bobrovsky was not part of the meeting today. But you wonder if they're not on the same page, you know, contractually as well. But we don't know that about Bob. That information is not, despite best efforts, that information's not been made available.
We do know a couple of guys that have re-signed, Oliver Bjorkstrand and Ryan Murray. And in the case of these two, as we look at their contracts and the numbers, what's your read on these decisions, particularly in the case of Oliver Bjorkstrand? Effusive in his praise of Bjorkstrand was Jarmo Kekalainen, the organization very high on him.
Yeah, and they should be. Quietly, and that's the word that keeps being used in describing his season, but he quietly had 40 points last season. It was the fourth best scorer among forwards, which would surprise people as well, and limited ice time. Now, the ice time started to creep up towards the end of the season when John Tortorella gained more faith in him. Has a wicked shot, great release. Was the MVP of the AHL Calder Cup team in Cleveland a couple of years ago. So he's done big things in big games there. They're very high on him. Murray's is an interesting situation. He accepted his qualifying offer, basically. And this is a year for Murray, and he's been beset by injuries early in his career. He has had an 82-game season just a couple of years ago, but missed significant time again last year with an injury. When he plays, he is a good player, and this is a really good team. But that first part of the sentence is the question mark. When does he play? When does he stay in the lineup long term? There's a big role waiting for him this season. Again, if he can stay healthy. Ian Cole left via free agency. Jack Johnson left via free agency. Those are two guys on the left side of that defense that are now out of the way. So on paper, anyways, Murray now starts the season next to David Savard as the second pair defenseman in a pretty prominent role for this team.
Aaron, one other player that is entering the final year of his contract in a different situation as a potential RFA is Zach Werenski. Anything in terms of his potential signing, maybe that kind of long-term contract that teams like to do with young core players like that?
Yeah, the sense I've gotten there is that the plan is to deal with him next summer. And this could be Werenski's decision or wish as much as the team's. As great as he's been in the first couple of seasons, I think he's got 27 goals his first 2 years in the NHL. He has not been fully healthy for an entire year either. He scored 16 goals last year and didn't have full use of one of his arms. I think it was his left shoulder for much of the year. So what could this kid do when healthy? He's been a dazzling player at times, young in his career here. And he's absolutely a guy who's going to sign a long-term deal, I think, with his next contract. But my sense, and again, this could change as well, but my sense is that waits until next season. And he probably goes into his UFA years next year because they have that level of faith with him.
Very thorough insights, as always, Aaron Portsline. You're no magician, but you really do have your pulse on the finger of all things Columbus Blue Jackets. Thanks for joining us.
Well, thank you. Thanks, guys.